How did you come about getting into filmmaking? It was obviously through your brother, Rob. Tell me about the journey to get to where you are at the moment.
Well, yeah, it's been a long time. Rob was the filmmaker in the family, and you know, was super-8ing on the walls as a young kid and splicing up, you know, footage and camera in hand the whole time. And I wasn't at all. I loved watching what he was doing, I'm not a camera in hand man. I still aren't. I prefer not to be a camera operator because I'm shit out. So, late 90s, early 2000s, the opportunity came for us to work together. Robert played at Hawthorn and then went to Brisbane and lived up in Brisbane for a while. So when we talked about it, and there was some circumstances that happened I won't go into, but we thought it's a good chance for us to have a crack at it. And we just started off as green as, really. So basically I was kind of like the line producer for him, really. And he was the creative genius. Mm. I still think he's the best I've seen. And so I just sort of, you know, flew along on his coattails, really, initially, and just learning and watching. And it was one of those things, I think, in life, sometimes as a young kid, I'd done some various things out of school, and it was like I wasn't quite really sure what was my passion or what I was good at. So we both actually worked at the National Safety Council, which was an old company up in Gippsland, which is no longer, but that's another story in itself. But so I was sort of floating around a bit, and then this gave me some, I was also learning before I started, I was doing interviews, recruiting and stuff. So I was actually learning without knowing what I was going to do later on anyway, because I started to learn how to interview and things like that. So I was doing a lot of that, which I look back now and think that's formed the basis of what I do now. It's quite amazing how life turns around. So once we got together, and I remember, and I used to lie on the ground holding the boom and stuff when Rob was doing interviews, and I was thinking, even back then, I loved the interview aspect of it, and I was so, it's just all evolved. So we started off with our first, he managed to get up, because of his name in the footy industry, he managed to get up the passion to play. So we got investment so it was our first investment in it, and in money coming into our little company. We called ourselves Hush Productions, because we used to go to the cinema a lot, and we used to hate people talking or eating in the cinema, so Hush was a natural evolution. So we did that. And that first documentary, I think back now and I just think, wow, like we were so green, and it's a mountain of work, a big feature documentary, and that one was over 2 hours and over 180 players interviewed. It was a monster, and it took 12 to 18 months. We had started with nothing, really. We set up ourselves as we went. We were buying cameras, and it was just a real baptism of fire kind of thing. So, but you know, I think, and both of us, we're not classically trained. We weren't, you know, in media school, media studies, and all that sort of stuff. It was more a natural. And I think about that now, and I think even that's probably the difference we have. We take it from another angle than a lot of producers and directors who have come up in the industry. We're kind of our own style, and what was Rob's style, and then I've sort of, you know, changed it into mine after we lost Rob. So yeah, it's kind of, what's the word? Interesting way to learn this business, I think, but we just learnt by doing it. You know, some people go to studies and stuff, but we were actually just out there doing it. And I think that's, for me now, I don't think you can do that these days, because I think to get in you need to have certain things, but I'm old now. But we just did it and worked hard, didn't get paid much, and just kept going and going and going. And what happens, I think, then is you build up, especially Rob in those years, they've built up so much trust within the footy industry, within clubs, which, you know, I was with him, so that sort of passed on to me, and that in itself gives you access. So we've been very fortunate with that, but at the same time, you have to produce great stuff to keep going. So, and you know, tonight's the airing of the first doco on Channel 9. I was saying to someone this morning, it sort of hit me that this, it's probably about the, I'd say it's about the 13th or 14th, you know, sports documentary that's been taken on broadcast in this country, which I don't think has been done before, especially from two brothers. So,
yeah,
you know, that makes me feel really, I was thinking about that this morning actually, and just, it's only now you stop and think about it because I'm too busy making it.
Yes.
To probably enjoy the process, but I'll hopefully the next few weeks think about what I've just done and, yeah.
Some time to reflect.
Time to reflect.
It's, I mean, it's fantastic. I've watched, I think, three of the episodes online, but you obviously get along to watch tonight, everyone. So when I watch, I mean, I guess a couple of questions there. First of all, Cricket Australia, did they approach you to, mm-hmm. and what was, why?
So what happened was Ben Amafio and Richard Ostroff from Cricket Australia first. I spoke to Ben, I think it was a few years ago now, and I've known Ben for a long while, and, off and on. He used to be at the AFL years ago, and just he's aware of my work, and Cricket Australia were aware of my work within footy. So the conversation sort of started, but they take so long to make that you have to have a window to do it. Now, they also wanted to launch their Cricket Australia Productions, which is a new arm they've created. So this was the first step for them into a big feature. So they were looking for someone to do it. So then they approached me, and I love cricket tragic. So and just the stars aligned. There were certain things that had to happen. You know, there's lots of things that go on behind something like this before you can get it up with rights and a broadcaster. And so it all sort of came together, and I had the time to do it. So that was what happened.
I mean, the thing that struck me as well, Peter, when you, first of all, the amount of people that you've involved to speak to, and we're talking some of the greats of both England and Australia, like obviously going back to the early days and now.
Yeah.
What was it like to get access to those sorts of people and get them so, and how did you get them so forthcoming? Because it was very honest and quite raw, some of those interviews that you had with these guys.
Yeah, it's a good question. Well, Cricket Australia were, you know, the big support behind the whole thing. They got it up. But essentially, from my perspective, I had to go and get the guys, okay? Because, you know, Cricket Australia lead you in, but then you've got to, you know, they've got to want to deal with you because I'm making it independently. So that was a massive task early on. I just had to start at some point. So, I mean, little stories like the Channel 9 commentary team, were fantastic because clearly it's a Channel 9 product, so I was able to get access to them. My dad's really good friends with Bill Laurie, so he rang Bill. So, and then a couple of the players like Gilchrist, Langer, Warne, a few of those guys were really helpful in pushing me into guys like Vaughan in England. So without that, you can't get them. If I'm cold calling someone in England and you're making a documentary in Australia, it just can't happen. So John Embry was another who I knew well, so he got me a lot of the past players in England and put a good word into the likes of both of them and so forth. So when I think back, like, I had, with footy I've always had easy access because they know my work, even past players and Rob's work. So, you know, if you mention it, they're like, okay, they know it's coming. But cricket, unless, A lot of the cricketers in Australia knew, oh, they've seen footy and they love footy stuff, but the English blokes, they're looking at me going, who the hell are you, kind of thing. So, yeah, that was difficult. And I remember flying to England, I was telling someone about this as well this morning, I said, when we got to England, I pretty much had two or three only locked in, and I needed in the 20s.
Wow.
So, And from there it snowballed. You know, you get one, you'd show them a few things, that they bring another. That's how it all happened.
The style, Peter, it's quite effective because you speak to Langer and he talks about an incident where he got hit in the head, involving, you know, a fast bowler from England. Then you cut to the fast bowler. Like it's almost like they're having a conversation, but you involve.
The crafting of it is think the most difficult part of it. I mean, well, you mentioned before the interviews. I don't know what it is. It's just something that we've had for a long time. I guess my brother as well. Was somehow, I don't know whether it's our manner or how we do it, or but it's conversational, and I think the trust that they have that you're not going to burn them is massive, and they have to like the way you present. So you need to have a body of work, I think, to get over the line with these things. So I definitely showed them some stuff before it, so they knew the sort of feel of it. And what happens is once they started seeing what other guys were saying, it became this irreverent piece. So they were very comfortable with letting it out. And I think in cricket, it's something that hasn't really been done before.
Yes.
So they were up for it. Kind of, it's not a run of the mill kind of documentary at all.
Yeah.
It's but yeah, the crafting. So the writing of it. When I say writing, the logging of interviews and the transcribing and then trying to get the story in my head and then crunching out edits and writing. So that is the really hard slog of what do I have archive wise, what do I have interview wise, what do I have picture wise, what can I access, and then try to meld it all together into a flowing narrative, which people watch documentaries, and I appreciate them all the time. So I go, I know how hard that was to do that. But
yeah.
You know, your punter out there just doesn't have a clue about that sort of thing. They just enjoy the show.
Yeah.
You know, I think, how come it took that long to make?
Yeah.
You know, but
yeah. Yeah.
That's the craft of it. And you know, so people either like your style or they don't. I'm comfortable with that because I'm not a. There are some old schoolers who love the scripted. Voiceover links to things, and I've just never really enjoyed that style. Not to say it's right or wrong, it's probably right.
Yeah.
I'm probably wrong, but I just think it gives more time for the players I'm dealing with to tell their story and not have someone else tell it.
Yes.
So, that's a battle, and that's what really. By the time but when I end a documentary, that's what's exhausted me the most is that fear of, and I got a massive fear of failure. I think I suffer self doubt whether things are good or not. But I think everyone who makes this has that somehow, because you have to, otherwise, you know, you don't know what you're producing. But yeah, so get to the end and take a breath and go, well, let's just hope people like it.
Yeah, just finally, it's just time. How would you summarise the Fortune Fire documentary, and when you reflect back, what are you trying to invoke? What emotion, what response, ideally, are you trying to get from your audience?
Yeah, it's a good question. There's a couple of things I desperately want people to have with my docos. I just simply want them to be entertained. I want to hold them. Nothing worse than watching a really good seg and then a really boring seg of something and go, well, you know what I mean? So I want to entertain them. I want them to feel something. I want emotion to come out. And the way that happens is, and music's a big thing for me. I like to, I spend hundreds of hours trying to find the right match for the feel of that segment or the feel of that piece. So I just want people to come away from it with, I want more. And the people I'm working with, I can't. Some people go, oh, it's a no-brainer, you've got legends. But you still got to make it work. You just can't pop a legend in front of a camera. I mean, you know what I mean? You've got to make it work and you've got to make it sing. But this one more than any other, I think the honesty and the rawness of the players makes it, and the irreverence of it. But yeah, at the end of the day, I initially started thinking, I'd love people to fall in love with Test cricket again. You have all these things at the beginning where you think, that's what I want. What happened was, funnily, I fell in love with Test cricket again through it. I fell in love with the Ashes again, because it reminded me of my childhood a lot, of what I used to enjoy and love about cricket. As you get older, you kind of lose that a bit, and you know, those larger than life characters I think aren't quite there now, because there's such a saturation of, you see them all the time. It's such a saturation of content. Whereas, you know, I never heard from Tomo and Lily when I was growing up. I just thought, oh, they're just, it's just magic. But so I had all these, I always start with all these things I'm going to, you know, end up with this, and it just turns itself on its head, do you know what I mean? And so, but I think hopefully people who have watched it, and if you're watching this, watch it, get a DVD or watch it online. But yeah, hopefully they come out of it and go, wow, that was, you know, that's something to really enjoy and remember.